Universal California. And the speaker, the president here this morning. Since he is so well known, I'm afraid he needs no introduction. But as chairman of this meeting, it is my particular pleasure to introduce him as follows. Professor Bell obtained his Doctor Bachelor of Science degree and also Doctor of Science degree in chemical engineering at Massachusetts Institute of Technology and became assistant professor of chemical engineering, University of California, Berkeley in 1967. Since 1976, he is a professor of chemical engineering at Berkeley and is now chairman of the Department of Chemical Engineering since 1981. Professor Bill Rickert is currently engaged in several of projects related to the synthesis of hydrocarbons and oxygenated compounds. The emphasis of this work is on identifying absorbed species of importance to catalysis, elucidation of reaction pathways, and understanding the influence of metal support and metal promoter interactions on catalyst selectivity and activity. Professor Bell has also recently initiated two new projects. One concerns a transition metal compound and the other development of a molecular understanding of zeolite synthesis. Professor Bell has received so many honors which cannot be mentioned all of them in a limited time. So I have only mentioned the most important one, that is, he received four MS awards in 1985 and was elected to the National Academy of Engineering in 1987. The title of his talk this morning is Advances in Understanding the Hydrogenation of Carbon Monoxide over Group 8 Metals.
Shown that if you'd like to make very high molecular weight product mix suitable for making diesel fuel, motor fuels, that one might use a cobalt or a titanium catalyst. Such a catalyst, in fact, has been developed by Shell, and they will be planned very soon in South Pacific. Alternatively, if one is interested in making a variety of alcohols for purposes of blending in with gasoline, one can use the newly developed IFC catalyst, which is a combination of cobalt, copper, zinc, and aluminum. If only ethanol is of interest, then recent work done under the C1 project in Japan has taught us that one can use a very complex rhodium catalyst that is promoted with iron, manganese, and a number of other elements in order to achieve both high selectivity for methanol. So what we see here then is that we indeed have a very versatile reagent that is here to make a variety of products, and the catalysis plays a central role in achieving the directions. Now, the last 15 years have often been referred to as the period of renaissance in the area of syngas chemistry. That's with good reason, because following the post-war period, where a great deal of activity was initiated and pursued, there was a period of quiet while we exploited the petroleum resource that was more abundant. However, in 1975, it became apparent that these resources were limited. At that time, scarce supply, and so there was incentive to reignite and reinvestigate this important area of chemistry. Now, in the past 15 years, we've seen development in a number of interesting areas. One has been towards the development, identification, catalysts that exhibit higher activity and selectivity than the catalysts that were known previously. And secondly, scientific undertakings have begun to show that we really can understand some of the elementary chemistry that attends the conversion of these two simple molecules, CO and hydrogen, into this slate of products shown on the right-hand side. Of this latter area, really, that I'd like to emphasize in this lecture, I'd like to talk about the chemistry and what you can learn about the conversion of CO to hydrogen. Now, to give you some perspective on this subject, I'd like to talk for a few minutes about the information contained on the slide. This is an attempt to summarize the work of very many people in the last decade or so, have been directed towards understanding the chemistry by which CO and hydrogen have converted to hydrocarbons. So we see here at the top the absorption of CO in the molecular state, while at the same time hydrogen is chemiabsorbed in the atomic state. There is now convincing evidence that in order to form hydrocarbons, the CO bond has to be ruptured. This is shown here in the second step. This releases carbon and oxygen. The oxygen very rapidly removes from the metal surface to make water, and therefore doesn't occupy any space. The carbon then reacts with the atomic hydrogen to make a mixture of partially hydrogenated C1 species. And these then serve as the precursors to either methane or carbon. By beginning at the linearization sequence, one can form higher order chains, which ultimately lead to the olefins, paraffins that we recognize as the product of this reaction. Now, there are a number of issues that have arisen concerning this mechanism. Let me begin again at the top. It's becoming increasingly clear that one of the reasons that synthesis gas chemistry is slow relative to many other catalytic reactions is that this very first step is in fact slow and is a difficult step to achieve. And therefore, we would like to know more about how one activates CO, either to partially stretch the carbon-oxygen bond or to achieve its total rupture. We'd also like to know something about the olefins that are formed in the product, by ethylene, and whether about the species that are present in all compatible surface and the chemistry. And so here I've outlined for us really the balance of this talk in terms of 4 points. I'm going to talk about factors influencing the activation of CO, the nature of the absorbed species that are present, and the reactions that these species undergo, the effects of secondary reactions on ultimate product slate that we observe. And finally, I'd like to turn to a newer theme, which is the utility of theory. We always think of theory as the unifying glue, if you like, that links empirical observations and makes these understandable and leads to our ability to then think in a forward direction about how we might manipulate the system. Now, I will be showing you towards the end of this talk that some recently developed theory can be very helpful in both understanding what is going on the surface of a synthesis gas catalyst and perhaps even giving us some insights as to what might be done next. So let's turn to the first of these 4 topics and talk about the activation of CO. I've listed here 5 factors that one must consider in examining how CO is activated. These are based really on work published in the literature. The first, of course, is metal composition. The second is metal dispersion. This is important because we now know microscopy, that as we change dispersion, we change the appearance or the morphology of small metal particles, and with this, the types of planes and the types of sites that are exposed to the surface, as we shall see, these influence the activation of CO. The mode of CO absorption is also important. We'll see that not all molecules of CO participate in CO hydrogenation. A more recent idea, and one which is, I think, becoming more important, is the role of hydrogen in activating CO. We'll see that empirical, experimental, theoretical evidence now suggests that hydrogen gets into the act at a very early stage and assists in the activation of CO. And finally, a theme that has been very topical in catalysis is the influence of metal oxide promoters the activation of carbon dioxide. So let's look first at the theme of dissociation of CO on transition metals. Now here I've taken the portion of the periodic chart that's relevant for this discussion, and I've divided it with the solid line, heavy solid line that runs in the staircase fashion between those elements which dissociate CO upon absorption at room temperature and those which do not. Dissociating elements are on the left, the non-dissociating elements are on the right. And the divider is placed here on the basis of experimental work done in the field of surface science. And it's apparent that the elements on the left of any of the transition series do dissociate CO, those to the right do not. The reason for this is now understandable. We examine the heats of absorption of oxygen and carbon on these elements. We discovered that there is a systematic increase as we progress from the right to the left. It's this increase that gives rise to a lower activation energy or the dissociation and therefore the appearance of carbon and oxygen upon absorption of CO. Mathematically, this is equivalent to taking the inverse Fourier transform of the signature. Showing the results here, so what we get is a spectrum of activities. Here, this is a distribution function. K is the rate coefficient of hydrogenated carbon to methane. Distribution of reactivities. And we notice that it's bipolar in character. The smaller, broader peak over here, and higher K value, is due to the hydrogenation of alpha carbon. And the spike-like here at lower values of K is due to the hydrogenation of beta carbon. The ratio of the areas under these peaks gives us the ratio of beta to alpha carbon. Turns out that this ratio is used from this analysis of the transient very good agreement with what we observe by an Washington Council. Completely independent. So this shows us what we can do, what I call kinetic spectroscopy, to analyze the behavior of these triangles. Well, here I'm illustrating that the surface concentration of the alpha carbon correlates very nicely in a linear fashion with the observed rate of methane formation. In the next slide, I show a different point, namely that the distribution of products produced from the alpha carbon follows an Anderson-Schultz-Morey distribution, where we have the log of the proportion of the particular product versus carbon. These particular results are from the recent work of Bergman Shulari, who's at the University of Michigan, U.S. You see here for the alpha carbon, Anderson-Schultz-Morey distribution, the beta carbon does not that kind of distribution. These products are the result of hydrogenolysis of the alpha crystals. Let me turn now to the third topic here, deal with that briefly. We know that alpha olefins are produced as primary products of CO hydrogenation over all transition metals. We can ask then, do these olefins simply leave the reactor, or do they participate in further reaction? Well, it's been well established that you can hydrogenate olefins in the presence of CO. And the support material is acidic, and the alpha olefin will be converted to beta and gamma olefins. But of greater interest is the question of whether such olefins will initiate growth of new chains and propagate new chains. So recently, what we have done is to investigate this problem by blending in unlabeled ethylene with C13 labeled carbon monoxide. What I'm showing you here is the distribution of hydrocarbons as a function of the partial pressure of the ethylene that we produce. So at zero here is the baseline, shows the distribution, characteristics for this medium of silica catalyst. And we notice here that as we produce more ethylene, the product mix changes quite dramatically. In particular, what is quite interesting is the amount of carbon caused can be suppressed quite substantially. You know, we find more than an order of magnitude. Concurrently, build up the higher molecular weight products, and particularly the C4s, create substantial. Similar experiments have also been done with propylene and butylene. Similar patterns are observed, but it turns out the higher molecular weight analogs are not as effective. Now, what's interesting is if we go and interrogate the isotopic composition of the products, we find that we can plot both the C12 and C13 labeled products on an Anderson-Schultz-Morey plot, and they exhibit exactly the same slope, the same value of alpha. C12 products have to derive from ethylene, C13, from CO. What's remarkable here is that the majority of the products are C12 derived, not C13. In fact, what we find is that the addition of ethylene results in a slight suppression of the conversion of carbon monoxide to hydrocarbon products. The fact that the slope here, the 13 labeled carbons, indicates that we're building hydrocarbon chains from a pool of carbon in which there's 12 and 13 labeled, but the chain growth process doesn't know that the carbons are labeled. If it did, then we would have different slopes. Another thing that happens when we add ethylene is that we increase the production of oxygen in the product. The dominant increase by far and away is the coupling. The product will be produced by the coupling of C13 labeled carbon monoxide to the ethylene to produce propanol and some smaller amounts of propanol. This is a direct indication of hydrobromylation, another kind of secondary reaction. Similarly, we use propylene or butylene, we can see the hydrobromylation in these cases as well. Here I show a scheme by which we might interpret this chemistry. CO comes in to make a C1 surface species, C1 monomer, and these monomer units can then link up with entire chains, and these chains then come along to more products. The ethylene can come in and also produce C1 but also C2 surface species, and then it too can act as a building unit. And so we see the full mainland here of species derived from ethylene and the carbon dioxide. Of course, the carbon dioxide, we can take off some of the C2 intermediates in the form of oxygen. Well, lastly, I'd like to turn to the issue of theory. As I said earlier, theory is very important in helping guide our understanding of what is happening in any area. Recently, under the work of Yevgeny Shostakovich, Kodak Research Laboratories in Rochester, there has been a very easy-to-use theory developed, which is called on-order conservation loss potential method. And this approach allows us to calculate heat of absorption by molecules of electric charges and activation energies for simple surface reactions. So what I'd like to do in this last few minutes is to outline the nature of this theory and illustrative applications problem of CO hydrogenation. The elements of the theory are shown here on one slide. They assume that any interaction between pair of atoms, say an oxygen atom or a carbon atom, metal center, can be described by a Morse potential. That's shown here in the first line. X represents the bond order, which is scaled in terms of bond distance. And Q0 here is another scaling parameter that scales the energy. If we have a set of interactions, pairwise interactions, all we do is add these up. Under the constraint that all partial bond orders have the sum of units. And then one finds the heat absorption by minimizing the total energy, keeping the constraint of the bond order. For further details, how this is all accomplished, I turn your attention to this very readable summary that appeared in surface science reports a few years ago. Now, an additional benefit of this approach is that one can calculate not only heat of absorption, but also activation energy. For the absorption of single atoms or absorbed molecules, the activation energy for absorption is equivalent here to heat of absorption. If we have associative recombination, the two atoms recombine the atom or molecule to form a product, then the activation energy is given by this type of expression here, where we take into account heat of absorption. Now let's look at how this all pertains to CO hydrogenation. I'm showing you here a diagram of the energy profile for the formation of methane. On and there are three paths that are associated. First involves the direct association of CO to produce carbon and oxygen, and then the stepwise hydrogenation of the carbon to produce methane. Notice that the first step has a rather high activation barrier here. It actually calculates 67 skin counts. The next step is an alternate path. Start out again with CO and hydrogen absorbed, but instead of dissociating CO, we'll add one unit of hydrogen to the CO and make a 4-methyl group. And then they'll allow that 4-methyl group to undergo dissociation, carbon, and OH. Well, in this case, the activation energy for cleavage of the carbon oxygen bond, 4-methyl, relative to the baseline of your CO energy, is higher than in the first case, where a quarter of 80 kilocalories rather. So, the bond order conservation theory tells us that this is a less likely process, far less likely process to occur. The third alternative that we can consider is that the 4-methyl group is formed, and then we add yet another unit of hydrogen to form the formaldehyde adsorbed. Right? Notice the activation energy for that is not as bad, it's somewhere about 60 kilocalories that we drop down. With a little more addition of hydrogen, not a much higher activation energy. This activation energy, by the way, is the same as this one here. So, form the oxygen. So, could follow this path to methoxide. And I want to ask, is methoxide a possible precursor to methane? Well, I think the answer is yes, because our calculations say that if we form methoxide, the next step would be preferred in associating this methoxide to methyl monosters, rather than adding one more hydrogen unit to form methanol. So this is about 20 kilocalorie larger activation energy for nickel to form methanol. The conclusion here is that nickel, monomer conservation theory, would suggest that association of CO could occur either directly or via the cleavage of the methoxide. And it's interesting to note that nickel experimental work also shows that if you add hydrogen, facilitates the cleavage of the CO bond. Let's look at palladium, which is a different story. In this case, the same three pathways, we find that for the direct association, the activation energy is very large. Order 100 kilocalories. Similarly, the activation energy for the cleavage from the corneal species is very high, and it therefore appears that both of these paths, both direct association and association from corneal, are unlikely. On the other hand, the path that proceeds via the methoxide has lower the set of activation energies and is far more favorable. Therefore, we would that the formation of methane on palladium probably proceeds not by the direct association of CO produced carbon, but by the hydrogen assisted association process going through the path of the methoxide. Notice also that in contrast to nickel, when we get to the methoxide, here the activation energy to form the methanol is lower than the dissociation. So we would expect that on palladium, we would form methanol in addition to methane. In fact, recent work done by Lane Whitney at Sandia Laboratories of semi crystals of palladium has shown just that one can form methanol as well as methane. Well, finally, I want to show you one more slide on the UOC method. This now contains the steps involved in the formation of higher electrolyte products. Here we have chain growth, CO insertion called an acyl, which can then be converted to aldehyde, and the termination steps to olefin and paraffin. Now, I have to draw your attention to a mistake on this slide. This set of numbers simply replicate the last set, and therefore it's an error. You really should be looking at about 40 kilocalories here and an order of 20 kilocalories in this. Well, there are two points that I'd like to bring out with the aid. First is that the addition of a CH2 group to CH3 is an exothermic process. This we can deduce by looking at the relative energies in the forward and reverse directions of the reaction. By contrast, the enthalpy of reaction for CO addition is positive or endothermic. So what we see then is that we have exothermic chain growth, endothermic insertion. This suggests that I explain why the formation of aldehydes and alcohols on the surface of metals such as iron, nickel, and platinum doesn't occur as readily as the formation of hydrocarbons. And that would be because the step that is critical to forming the C2 aldehyde here is endothermic, and therefore unfavorable. Another thing that we can deduce from this slide concerns the formation of hydrocarbons. Well, notice the activation energy for the formation of olefins is higher than for the formation of paraffins. And so we would expect that as we increase temperature, we would make more olefin than paraffin. This has, in fact, been observed on iron in our laboratory. We worked very nice phase velocities to avoid the secondary hydrogenation of olefin, which causes, as you increase the temperature, proportion of olefin product. So the conclusion here, then, is that theory does give us additional insights into surface chemistry. Well, I've listed here the conclusions that I'd like to bring out from this talk. I've shown you that the activation of CO is affected by metal composition dispersion, interactions with take just one more minute here to ask, what does this all imply for the future? Well, what we've seen is that we can manipulate the activity of these catalysts by the introduction of corollas, particularly metalloxides. This, I think, holds a lot of promise for making very active and possibly selective catalysts for the synthesis treatment of years for the future. I know that there's a lot of active work in industry and in academic institutions in this direction. We've now convinced ourselves that the growth of chains, these binding products, is a polymerization process. The only thing we can control here is the degree of polymerization, or the ratio of the propagation and termination coefficients, but we can't bend the distribution relative. So we can then try to introduce promoters that alter the distribution of termination and propagation, and then use the products that are formed, feed them back, form olefins, try to initiate new chains, and alter the distribution by this kind of feedback. I'm showing evidence to suggest this should be possible. So one might think taking the ethylene and propylene, which are not useful as fuel products, and feeding these back to the front end of the reactor to alter the product selection. So finally, I'd like to acknowledge my co-workers in this effort. At the top, I listed the various graduate students who have worked with me during the past 15 years in this area. Without their efforts, this would have been impossible. In the middle here, I've identified three individuals who have worked with me. These are senior investigators. Michael Duncan is a researcher at AT&T Bell Laboratories, who introduced us to MR spectroscopy. James Shostorovich, as I mentioned, is at Kodak Laboratories, still collaborating with them. Mike DePontis was a postdoctoral student who came and worked with us for a year in South Africa. Missing from the slide, Rail Mission is Kathleen Lee, who has recently been working with me. She is from the University of Paris. Finally, I'd like to also acknowledge the support of the U.S. Department of Energy. Mentioned that without the financial support, none of what I'm saying would be possible. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Eric. It was really a fascinating question. And I'd like to
turn right from Shell in Netherlands.